Hello, Dr. Mike here. This goes out to all my CIS2640 Security Plus / Network Security topic. It's topic number 4 on public key infrastructure, or known as PKI. So we are going to go ahead and talk about the chat material, and I got some extra stuff to go over that's not in the book. And I will link to a tag of a previous video on the previous textbook and course material, a little more in depth on some areas. However, this lecture will match this course material here. So, in any case, PKI. So we came off chapter, the previous chapter, which was chapter 15 in this textbook, on encryption, and we talked about really how encryption works. But there's actually another level here, and it's the public key infrastructure, and really about how we manage to ensure security with this encryption. So when we exchange keys, how do we know the key we've gotten is from the person who they say they are? And probably the biggest thing one of you know is our certificate authorities. And we see this here like in the web browser. So we can view certificates for websites we hit, and usually it's part of the SSHTTPS standard. You get the little lock in the browser, depending on the web browser. Based on various things, and one of course is the use of HTTPS and also the certificate being done correctly. So you can get the details. Now this is actually called an X509. There's actually a base policy to use for this, and it really does is it gives a standard that all certificate authorities can use to show what's inside there. So the server itself, the serial number of the certificate, the version number, the algorithm SHA-256 with RSA encryption that's being used, and so on. So I'm going to go and not go into all these details here, but there I just realize there's a standard that's being used, and most of the time it's really hands off. When you work with a certificate authority, registration authority, they sort of follow the standard. So just to be sure, just in case if you were set up a series of servers and you were put in charge of security, you want to make sure that whoever they chose is using a X509 security cell, which you probably are. Which is nice, right? That way it's not this certificate authority has their own standard and so on. So in any case, we see that in our web browser. And this comes through what was known as the certificate authority, registration authorities. There is a hierarchy we're going to look at here. But really, is this graphic on 16-1 here? It gives you an idea about how you create your own key, how it's stored, and then can we trust the key? Can we trust the website? Can we trust who the server is? So when the server says it's eLearn or it's Google, I can trust with the certificate that there's a third party that says yes, the certificate that they gave me matches what I have, and I'm telling you that it does match. So that way, you can sort of block called man-in-the-middle attacks. It's up to a point. or a rogue server. So again, we see this within our trusted root authority. All operating systems have some sort of certificates stored online. I'm sorry, offline on your computer. And this uses access to your web browser. A lot of times you can manage these or through the OS. And it's going to depend, even for mobile and desktop. Again, X509 is our standard, so be sure that you just know that. It's good to know that we have a standard for that, and we see there's different issuers. So there's a lot of different issuers, and there's a whole hierarchy with this. It's important to understand that certificates go through a certain thing. There's revocation, recovery. And then there's different states our certificates go through. So it's important that when a certificate's revoked, that it is uploaded, it's basically updated in the database. Hence, you don't delete it. You sort of state this certificate's been revoked. Either the server's gone removed or this company's no more. And you don't want someone come in and pretend to be that company. And if you remove the certificate, delete it, then there's nothing to say that that's not who they said they are. So it's used in that manner also. Textbook talks about revocation, key recovery, because you can be reinstated. Also, MFN authentication. I may have talked about this in the previous one. Idea being you break up the key itself into smaller chunks. So not everyone has the full, not all parties have the full key. They all have parts of it. And this is also looking at the key escrow and trust model. So it's a pretty short chapter here. And again, I'll link to the previous one, goes really into detail about the trust models if you want to look at that. So in any case, let's talk about standards. So one of the biggest one, of course, is we have currently the FIPS 140-2, and you can see here there's a note here. There's actually a FIPS 140-3 in development, so which will soon be out. So again, it's important to know the standards. Most times you might not need to, as a security engineer, apply these standards, but understand what they are. But there could be, if you're working with your own type of key management, it's good to go and look at the standard. Now, if you look at the standard itself, you can see here everything from physical security. Here we have a finite state model, but general physical security requirements, how we use random number key generators. Again, talked about randomness in the previous lecture. Very important here. Very important random number generators, key establishment, storage, things like this. So how we deal with this kind of stuff, our different states, cryptographic states, physical security, multiple chip and grid cryptographic modules, and so on. So you can see, if you really are in deep into building your own key management at a company, FIPS 140 is definitely going to be the thing to look at. Keep that in mind. There's a link to this, I know, in the course show material, so you can always look that over. So let's talk about really how we, one of the big things that this PKI also does is it talks about how we do end-to-end encryption. So again, we need to be able to trust who we're talking to, who they said they are, trust the public key they gave us, is their public key. And this is going back to our RSA, which you can see here. This graphic talks about prime numbers end-to-end. And you can see how private key and public key are generated really from two. Now, remember that this is 10, these are not large, 11 and 17 is very small, but two very large prime numbers with factoring. So it is some basic factoring math here. This is what the backbone of RSA is, and so it creates the public private key pair, which again, previous video I talked about, really is scalable and allows for what we see here, a quick mobile device. The app itself can create a public-private key pair. Summit, the public key is certified on a server. And then this other end, the user who gets that can, check, almost like with our certificate authority in our web browser, verify that public key is for Alice. Bob can verify that. Bob can use his key to her key, public key to encrypt the file, and it gets decrypted with her private key. So this is really a cornerstone of how online shopping, online banking, online encryption, encrypted chat apps a lot of times work with this. So again, it comes down to prime numbers. It really is pretty amazing feat. That RSA was really a big turning point to allow for what we know as our online economy. So how do we do this? Again, there's different standards to look at, and we might talk about this a little bit in the previous topic. These two bleed over a lot. It's very common. So, but Diffie-Hellman is one, and Diffie-Hellman is going to go ahead and set up the standard that might be used for session generation. This is a very important topic as we talk and get to the next topic, which is attacks, network attacks, session attacks, session stealing, things like that. We gotta make sure we session is set up also in the same way. A lot of times, this is what Diffie-Hellman does. It allows the server, in this case SpongeBob, and maybe the client here, to go ahead and agree upon two numbers, and then create the private keys, calculate those private keys, and exchange the public keys off of those. And then this could be just for the initial session. From this, they might actually exchange their own private key. So again, this is going to depend upon the authentication level. A lot of times, though, Let's say I log into a shopping, I mean, I log into an account maybe on Amazon. It might use Diffie-Hellman to go ahead and get me logged in. And when I do an order, it might have a different set of keys. So you might actually have multiple key generations for session. So part of this is also session ID. I'm going to talk about this in future videos, especially in network attacks. And this goes back to the previous video, which is randomness. I can't state important how random it is. So you need to have this random seed. If you seed this with anything that's not random, if it could be guessed, poor session ID, poor session establishment is in something we're going to talk about in the future video. It comes back to how encryption is set up, which encryption is used, and how is it following a Diffie-Hellman standard, for example. And yeah. And we'll see it again. I guess a quick example would be a date timestamp with the user's maybe like a user ID number and then like a session number that's maybe just one 0 through 9999 and just is ticked up. You can almost go through and guess the next session ID that way. So again, that's a future video. We'll see that in the network attacks and attacks just portion of the class. So again, Diffie-Hellman. Again, used to go and create that initial set of keys. And really, you can go deeper down here. Down to the stack, so let's look at the OSI model, why our client server, our SYN, SYNACK, and ACK, right? We get the three establishments of the TCP session, client hello, server hello. During this time, it's gonna talk about, okay, what cipher suite can I support? Oh, I can support these cipher suites. Here, I have a nonce I'm going to use. Okay, use that nonce. Again, number used once, a nonce. There's an optional client authentication that can be done. Then we have their Diffie-Hellman exchange inside here. So here we exchange those numbers. Maybe it could be the nonce I used, and we agree upon the two key pairs. We get a pre-master secret. And then we can get our derived session keys from that. And then from this, we move into TLS, where negotiation is complete. And then we actually have an encrypted application back and forth. So this is going starting at a high level. And go deeper down here, as you can see, this does barrel down into our TCP IP stack. So quick example of that. So let's talk about ways we can test this. And this is something that's not in the chapter. So we looked, of course, at FIPS. FIPS 140, currently dash 2, looks like dash 3 is on the boards, it's being developed. But what tools can I use right out of the bat? And one of them I use a lot when I do testing, web-based testing. You can use this if you're internal, maybe you work for a DevOps, DevSecOps team, maybe you're the person in charge of the website for the company, or at least the security for the company. SSLLabs.com, Qualys Labs, they have a lot of tools. You can test your browser and so on. But just test your server. You can go here, you can put in your host name. And you can go ahead and say, don't show the results. We don't want to show up here on the board of best and worst recently seen and so on. Put in your host name, hit submit, let it run. It's going to run a quick test. And here you can see this is Sinclair's, the EDUs, and there's the IP address for the server it hit, when it was accessed. You get an overall rating. Now, first you gotta come off and say, why is everything an A rating? There's a key here, and the key is the customer. If the company has a website that supports maybe older versions of browsers, then those older versions of browsers will support older, sometimes less secure, underpinnings of technology, underpinnings of security. In this case, TLS, for example. 1.1.1 is capped. So it gets a B. Server supports a weak Diffie-Hellman key exchange. So just going through, and you can see the certificate details. This is almost like you saw here when I did look at the certificate details here. You get sort of the same details here. This is going to grab those details. And best thing is you can dump this to PDF, use this as a report, as part of a report and a security review. The key was used and so on, who signed it, so on. But we do is we get the configuration. So example, the Transport Layer Security 1.3 and 1.2. 1.2 is definitely the current one that you want to support. You might need to support older ones due to your business. You have to support all older technologies. So in this case, it might get a B, and you can see TLS 1.1 1.0 is done. Now, of course, SSL 3 and 2 are deprecated and old. If those are being supported, you probably get an F. In fact, if we look at one of the Fs here, yeah, basically really, really bad, invalid certificate names. But yeah, insecure. Insecure protocols being used. So let's go back to this one. So here we see the protocols being supported by our server, and also the cipher suites being supported. So again, these are weak ones. TLS 1.2 are weak. It's preferred over weak ones. You can see there's no. So we have some weak ones being supported. Handshake simulations are done, and it checks with different operating systems, different types of browsers. Android, Firefox, you can see. When it asks, what do you support? And this is going back to that graphic. Hey, what do you support? It is basically asking for the lowest. What's the lowest encryption I can have? And this is actually an attack vector you'll see in server attacks. So is to do this and say, okay, oh wow, you support this really weak SSL. Well, I know this weak SSL. Let's say, for example, SSL 2 was supported. Well, I know this has vulnerabilities against it. As an attacker, I can use this to build out an attack. So think like the attacker, but be prudent as a defender. So again, you can see here different protocol details, and a different zombie, the golden poodle, OpenSSL. Here we have different attacks, forward secrecy, is public key pinning supported, and so on. A lot of information here. Now where do you start? Like, there's a lot of data. You don't have to be, a total expert in this stuff. You can go here and say, okay, for Sinclair, why do we have a B? Well, we have a B because server supports weak Diffie-Hellman key exchange. I click on more information, and I get right here. The logjam attack for TLS protocol. So actually, now I have attacks I can tie to this weakness. And you can see how, if you're an attacker, this is fantastic. This is basically a map of what I can attack. Even a full technical paper, which I'm not going to get into here, but this is information you can use to build out a report on your server weaknesses or just your current server state. And maybe you can say, later on, you say, why do we support this? Well, we currently have two or three customers that need this. All right. Well, when they're off no longer, when they say they have upgraded their security, we need to upgrade ours too. So it allows you to go and upgrade quickly to improve your rating. And of course, a rating of A, that's a F1, a rating of A plus, you can see here is pretty solid state. Only supports TLS 1.2, only uses, looks like TLS, RSA with AES. Here we see those things, TLS, Transport Security, RSA with AES 256, right? So now let's go back to our previous chapter. You can see where those algorithms come into play here. You can see the cipher suites are being supported. All of them are using TLS 1.2 only. So whenever something like handshakes, I'm only supporting the latest and greatest security, Firefox 7.3, Win 10. And that's RSA with 2048, SG256. So in any case, fantastic utility. That's SSL Labs. And doesn't really talk about it here too much in the chapter, but I want to expose that to you here in my thing. If you come from the chapter, though, understand trust verification, trust authority, certificate authorities, and overall just how we use our key exchange revocation and key escrow. So, and trust models is the last thing I'll leave here. Go and look that over. That's a pretty short thing about trust models. Again, earlier on, I did a link to an earlier video which goes a little more into detail if you want to get more into that. So, in case that wraps up topic 4 on public key infrastructure. Thank you.